modeling. Modeling a vibratory system. Don't tell me this is wrong because double L is not wrong. Depends on whether you're using English English or American English. So, since I've been penalized in writing papers for grammatical mistakes I've had. Besides the fact that you have two vowels here, right? So it should be doubled anyway. So, we covered two approaches. One was, we call that simple systems. These are systems, the mass is clear, the stiffness is clear, so very easy, relatively easy, so we can just set up a free body diagram and directly derive equation of motion, and then you find whatever this term is would be your mass equivalent, and the coefficient of u would be your k equivalent. So that was approach number one. The second approach, I call that structural analysis. We did quite a few examples using that approach. I could not find a better theme to describe that, but that's what it was. This is for more complicated systems that it really comes down to how you identify the stiffness element, which is more, in fact, difficult than the mass. And using a variety of structure analysis methods that you've seen in statics or stress analysis, which is basically how to relate the stiffness to deformation, force to deformation, you came up with equivalent stiffness. So this was either based on definition of stiffness, conceptual, or definition of flexibility. We did a problem last time, which is the inverse of a stiffness. And utilizing, you know, techniques like superposition, when you have a complex loading, complex system, that you have to break it apart. We did an example. And then we also learned the concept of parallel or series combination of a spring, which depending on whether you have the same force or same displacement that the stiffness are subjected to, you can add them up. So that's what we covered in two sessions. What we are going to introduce now, I call that energy methods. Or to be more precise, in fact, mainly would be the principle of conservation of energy. That's what we are going to demonstrate, how by using this concept, you can do a lot of things. Derive the equation of motion, given the displacement response, you can find the natural frequency of the system. You can do a variety of things that you could not do easily with either of these two approaches, especially when you have a complex system. So let's first demonstrate, you know, present the simple concept or the simple formulation through a few examples, and then, you know, we'll see how you can apply that to some complex problems. So to start with, what is the principle of conservation of energy? We know that the kinetic energy, which is usually shown by V, I don't know why, and potential energy, which is shown by T, some of these two is constant if the system is conservative. That is, does not dissipate energy or absorbs energy. So if that's a constant, therefore, the derivative of this, obviously with respect to time, is zero. So this simple relationship can be used to do as I said, derive the equation of motion and solve the vibratory problems. So let's demonstrate that. Let's first start with a very simple model that we have and demonstrate how we can, just by using this, derive the equation of motion without the need for the second law of mechanics or free body diagrams or the Lambert force, any of that. If this is going to experience a displacement, right? So we have basically two components in this system. One is a mass, which is experiencing kinetic energy due to the velocity, and then a stiffness, which experiences potential or strain energy. Kinetic energy is easy, right? Remember that. That's kinetic energy. How about potential energy for this spring? If the spring elongates, we know that there's a relationship, linear relationship between the force in the spring and the displacement. And that relationship is a linear relationship. The slope of this linear function is that the stiffness, F is K times U. Energy is the area under this curve, right? So what is this area? At any point U, if this force is F, right, this area would be what? Would be F times U divided by 2, right? F is what? Is K times U. So if you just substitute that, you see that this then comes out to be 1/2 K U squared. So that's kinetic energy, this is the potential energy. So if you want to apply this principle to this system, what do you do? The kinetic energy of this mass is 1/2 m u dot squared. Its potential energy is 1/2 k u squared. You need to take the derivative of this sum, equate that to zero. That is a concept, right, a principle of conservation of energy. So let's take the derivative with respect to time. So you will have 1/2 m. Derivative of this is 2 u dot, u double dot, plus 1/2 k. Derivative of this term is 2 u dot u is equal to 0. U dot is a non-zero term, so you can just cross that out. So you just easily get m u double dot plus k u is equal to 0. So this is the first simple example to demonstrate how, by using the concept of principle of conservation of energy, you can directly derive the equation of motion. But we will demonstrate that, of course, through other examples. So let's show that through another example, when the system is not necessarily simple or mass and stiffness are given so directly. So I will use this example, which is very similar, not exactly the same as the example we had before. Let's say you have a mass M1 attached to this disk, which is pivoting about this point O. Another spring is attached to this end, and this disk is not massless, has a mass, M2, and is oscillating as a result of the motion of this mass up and down. And you want to set up the equation of motion. You can see that by using that structural analysis or other approaches we've seen, it's not easy to find or set up the equation of motion. But let's demonstrate the powerful technique of the principle of conservation of energy. If this mass is going through some displacement, let's call that U. If, of course, if this is inextensible, it's just a rigid bar, massless, so whatever displacement this experiences, this point A would go through the same displacement. Assume that this is, of course, is small. So the disk would rotate an angle phi, this mass going through this displacement u, and obviously, as a result of A going down, this point goes up, so this is also experiencing the same displacement. We assume u is small. If you assume u is very small, we ignore the potential energy of this mass. Is that clear, or do you have any question why? Because in the other section, somebody asked a question. If u is very, very small, which is actually the assumption we make throughout this whole course, that we assume this displacement is small, so we don't get into the nonlinear or inelastic range of deformation, and the mass is small, the potential energy of this mass would be very small. Necessarily, the velocity is not as small, because if the displacement is small, doesn't mean that velocity is small, it can be actually very large. And somebody may ask the question then, so if the displacement is small, why don't we ignore the potential energy of the spring? Because K might be large. But here, mass is small, U is small, so that can be ignored. So the energies that we have, as far as the kinetic energy, would be the kinetic energy of this mass, which is 1/2 m1 u dot squared, plus the kinetic energy of this disk, which going through some rotational motion. So it would be 1/2 of its mass moment of inertia times the rotational or the angular velocity squared. So that's the kinetic energy. However, you know there is a relationship between these two. If you look at this little triangle, u is, if this is r naught, would be r naught times phi. So you can convert one of these variables to the others. I'm going to keep everything in terms of phi. So let's substitute for u here. So this would be 1/2 m1 times r zero phi naught, or phi dot squared, plus 1/2 I phi dot squared. So this would be 1/2 m1 r naught squared phi dot squared plus 1/2 I phi dot squared. So that's the kinetic energy. So this is the kinetic energy, total kinetic energy. The only element that generates potential energy is this spring, goes through deformation u, so the potential energy would be 1/2 k u squared, or 1/2 k times r phi squared. So it would be 1/2 k, or r naught k, doesn't matter, phi squared. So this is the potential energy. So we need to just add these two, take the derivative of the summation with respect to time equate to zero to find the equation of motion. Take the derivative of this with respect to time. You have 1/2 m1 r, which is constant, so the only r naught zero, the only variable is this. Derivative of that is 2 phi double dot phi dot. This one plus 1/2 I, then would be 2 phi double dot phi dot, right? Derivative of this would be 1/2. Okay.
Professor.
This would be actually r squared. Right. Yeah, I just noticed it, just in time. So it would be 1/2 k r naught squared times 2 phi phi naught. This is equal to zero. Phi naught, the velocity, is not zero, so you can divide both sides by that and just simplify that a little bit. So you get M1 R naught squared plus I, okay, times phi double dot plus K R naught squared times phi is equal to zero, right? So coefficient of acceleration is your mass equivalent, coefficient of the displacement is your stiffness equivalent. So natural frequency would be just K R naught squared divided by I plus M1 R naught squared. Okay. And of course, for a disk rotating about the center of mass, you know that I is 1/2 M2 R naught squared. So if you want, you can substitute that here. So you express that in terms of the two masses that you have. I'm sure you agree with me that if you wanted to use either structural analysis approach or just direct derivation of the equation, would not be as easy. But this, as you can see, such a simple yet very powerful approach. Any question? No? Okay, let's do another problem. Okay. I want to demonstrate now that, in fact, this principle leads to some other simple sub-principles, as I call them, that also offer a very powerful approach to derive the equation of motion or find the natural frequency or dynamic characteristics of the system. So let's demonstrate that through an example. Okay, so I would call that some, observations. How about that? In other words, based on this concept, we can also conclude some other results, which helps us to develop tools based on this concept to derive the equation of motion. You remember in free vibration of an undamped system, we derived that. We haven't done much to it, but at least you remember it was like this, okay? It was an equation like this. So let's assume that initial velocity is zero. This is the equation of motion as a function of initial conditions. So let's say the initial velocity to begin with is zero. So you don't have this term. So this is your the response of the system. Okay? So now let's set up, this is vibratory motion. We have its equation of motion, or the response of the motion. And we want to find kinetic and potential energy based on that, right? So if this is the displacement, response, the velocity would be what? Would be negative omega n u dot sine omega n t, right? So kinetic energy would be what? For if this is a simple, you know, single linear freedom system experiencing an oscillatory motion. So it would be 1/2 m u dot squared. So it would be 1/2, right, this, or negative omega n u sine omega n t squared, omega n squared, u squared, right? So how much kinetic potential energy would be 1/2 K times U squared, okay? Or not U, not squared, right? Okay? So if that's the case, I'm going to do this. I will substitute for omega n squared, which is k over m here. So this becomes, okay, actually this is minus m, right? So if you substitute k over m, and this m cancel out, right? So let's add these two, right? So you have T plus V would be, I would just write it down, would become K, 1/2 K U naught squared times cosine omega N T squared plus sine omega N T squared. But this is one, right? So that means when U naught is zero, or right, the total energy would be the kinetic energy. You can prove the same thing that if U naught is zero, the total energy would be just m times u dot equal to zero. What does that mean? Let's demonstrate that through some graphic representation of this response, which you remember and you're familiar with, okay? If you had a single degree of freedom system, undamped, free vibration, this was the motion, the harmonic, basically, response, sinusoidal response, right? What happens here? When the displacement is at peak, or the maximum, velocity is zero, right? Slope of the curve is zero. So what is the total energy here? Total energy is 1/2 times U max squared. That means the maximum energy, potential energy, happens when the kinetic energy is zero. How about here? At this point, U is zero, right? But the velocity is actually maximum. Velocity is zero, starts increasing, here it is, it's maximum. That means at this point, the total energy is kinetic energy, which is its maximum value, right? Since the sum of these two is always a constant, right? Sum of the two, kinetic and potential energy, is always a constant, right? So what does that mean? That means that maximum potential energy is the same as the maximum kinetic energy. Sum is constant, right? One goes to zero, the other one is maximum, vice versa. This is a very simple conclusion we derive from that concept, but let's see how powerful this is to solve, in fact, some very interesting problems. Let me first demonstrate that if you have the time response of a system, how you can directly find the natural frequency of that system by using this concept. In free vibration of a damped system, okay, you know that displacement response was this. Right? So what is the maximum displacement? Is A, right, the amplitude. What is the maximum velocity? Take the derivative here, okay, is omega n A cosine omega n t plus theta. So then this is going to be, when this is one, this is maximum. So u dot max, if you substitute for A, would be omega n times u max, okay? Now let's find the two maximum energies, equate them to zero. So you have 1/2 k u max. It should be equal to the maximum kinetic energy, which is 1/2 times u dot max squared. Substitute for u dot max squared, which is omega n times u max squared, so omega n squared u max squared. U max are crossed out from the two sides. So what do you end up with? You end up with, the most important piece here. You end up with what? Omega n squared is k over m. What did we do? If we had the response of the system, by finding the maximum displacement and the maximum velocity, you can find the natural frequency, or the frequency of the oscillation, okay? Which is very powerful, again, approach. If you're given a time response, you can find the maximum displacement and the maximum velocity, you can find the frequency of that response, okay? So another application. Let's show that through a simple problem again. See, these are various examples that show you how energy method, very simple technique, how powerful it is. And this is, in fact, the best part of it is yet to come, which we'll discuss it on Wednesday. Okay. Let's say you want to design a system which can be used to absorb the impact load, or in other words, something that stops the motion of an object, a bumper of a car, can be used as an energy absorption system. Or a bulletproof plexiglass for, you know, stopping the bullet, right? Basically, in all these problems, if you assume you have an object that is moving with the velocity toward a system, a system is defined basically as a stiffness element, or in simple terms, a spring. Stiffness is not necessarily a spring. It's a mechanism that prevents deformation, right? So if, let's say, you want to design something like this to stop the motion of a particle or whatever is going towards that and hitting it, right, like an impact load, you can use the energy method as long as you assume that once this particle, which is moving with some initial velocity, okay, when it hits this spring, there is no energy loss or friction at the point of contact. This is going to continue, and obviously displace this spring, causing a maximum possible displacement. Let's say you have something like this. You've been given as an engineer a device, can be bumper of a car. You're told that the stiffness of this is, say, 17,500 newton per meter, and this object is moving at a initial velocity of 1.5 meters per second, you're talking about what? How many meters per minute? That would be 60 or 90 minutes. So 90 times 60, 5,400, about 5 kilometers, 5.5 kilometers per hour. So anyway, it's moving at that speed, and you want to know if this is adequate to stop this, or in other words, meeting your criteria. You want to find the maximum displacement that this causes. So you want to find out if the plexiglass that you selected is good enough. Because, for instance, there's a restriction that glass could not be deflected more than, say, 1 centimeter. So what you have here, you have what? The maximum kinetic energy at the time that this thing starts, or that this thing velocity is maximum, is equal to the maximum potential energy. It is when the spring experiences the maximum deflection, right? So in other words, 1/2 of K times U max squared is equal to the 1/2 M times U dot max squared. This is at the time that this thing is started, right? So you can find U max, right? So U max would be square root of that. So would be U dot, right, times M divided by K, or K divided by M. That would be U max. So you have this 1.5 meter per second. You have this 17,500 newton per meter. You have this is given. This was given 4.587 kilograms. You see that U max comes out to be 0.02, I think 204 or 204, 0.24 meter, or roughly about an inch, 2.4 centimeter. So if you were given the selection to choose this, you can decide whether it's good enough or not. Apparently not. So you need to choose a stiffer, maybe spring or piece of glass or whatever, bumper, to prevent, if your objective is not to reduce the displacement. So if the stiffness goes higher, obviously that's gonna be lower. But it's a very simple example of the concept which we derive based on the principle of conservation of energy. Okay. Any questions? No? Positive? Okay. So let's do another problem. Let's do this problem that we did last time to show again the power of the energy approach. He had a disc, a spring was attached to it like this, to the stiffness K, at a distance A from the center of rotation, and then the mass was attached to this disc, a small mass, M1. This time we are not going to ignore the mass of the disc, which we did previously because it was not easy otherwise to derive the equation of motion using structural analysis method. So we want to set up, again, equation of motion and find the natural frequency of the system. Okay. Again, let's look. The source of kinetic energy that we have is this mass and this mass that rotates about 0.0. As far as potential energy, again, we assume the displacement that this is experiencing is very, very small. So we ignore the potential energy of that mg, or that little weight. So if this is, if this rotates, or this comes down, this would rotate an angle phi. Let's call the radius of this 0, okay? And this is point B. Obviously, this is going through the same angular deformation, so the spring will experience a displacement of delta, which is a function of phi, right? So let's set up again the potential and kinetic energy. The only source of potential energy we have is the spring. So the potential energy is 1/2 k times delta squared. Delta is A times phi, right? So we have 1/2 k times delta squared, which becomes A squared phi squared. Again, U is R0 phi, so we can convert phi to U or vice versa. I would leave that as is. So I'll consider the variable for the displacement being phi. How about potential energy? Potential energy is 1/2 M1 U dot squared plus 1/2 moment of inertia of this phi dot squared. Again, remember, I is M2 times R naught squared. But I'm not going to substitute that. Leave it to the end. So I will substitute, however, for U, which is R times phi. Okay? So I have 1/2 M1 would be R squared phi naught squared. Okay. Plus 1/2 I phi dot squared. Okay. So this is the kinetic energy. Okay. This is potential energy, 1/2 times k a squared phi squared. You didn't tell me. I wrote delta. Then, you know, I said this means this would be that, right? So that's kinetic, that's the potential, that's kinetic. Okay? So now let's take the derivative of the sum of these two. Okay, so let's take the derivative of that is 1/2 M1 R naught times 2 phi double dot. This one, 1/2 I times 2 phi double dot. plus one half K A squared two phi phi dot is equal to zero. This is a non-zero term, so we can cross that out. Okay, let's factor out the common terms. So you have M1 R0 squared plus I, okay, phi double dot plus KA squared phi is equal to zero. So you can see that this is the K equivalent, this is M equivalent, so omega n, I don't know why it isn't, which is that, omega n would be K A squared divided by I plus M1 R0 squared. Maybe it would be better to do it in a different color. Okay, and if you remember the problem that we did, if you consider this to be zero, you get the same result. You have A over R naught times K over M. That was the special case that we did. So you can see, again, this is a very powerful method. And with that in mind, now on Wednesday, we will introduce the general approach.